Hi guys! So today's episode is not a regular Go Roughly Around the World episode. It is a special because we have a really important question that we want your feedback on. And that is, which route should we take north to the Arctic Ocean? Should we do the Dalton Highway or the Dempster Highway?
Okay, so tell us what the difference is.
Okay. So the Dalton Highway is the one that's in Alaska. It starts just outside of Fairbanks and it goes up towards Dead Horse. It's 666 kilometers.
Very ominous.
Yes.
But let that go.
And it is 25% pavement, not really good pavement. It's like pothole-y and bad, and 75% gravel and dirt. So that's in comparison to the Dempster Highway. So the Dempster Highway is on the Canadian side, and it starts just outside of Dawson City in the Yukon, and it goes north. And so there's a bit of conflicting information about where the Dempster actually ends, because originally it ended in Inuvik, and that stretch was considered the Dempster. But in, I think it was 2017, they added on this additional like 80-some miles towards Tuktoyaktuk in the Northwest Territories.
Which is just a great name. I mean, if you had to pick a place on a map that you wanted to go to for no other reason than because it has a name that is spectacular, Tuktoyaktuk is it.
Yeah. So Tuktoyaktuk, that distance from there back down to Dawson City is 740 kilometers. And it is 98% gravel and dirt. So those are the two different routes that we can take. And there are pros and cons of each. So let me talk through a little bit about this is the research that I've done.
Lay it out.
The Dalton Highway in Alaska. The good thing is that there is 25% pavement. So that gives me some sort of comfort there.
Little bits of breathing room there.
A little bit. But it is also, there's a lot of dirt. And there are some steep grades, like 12%, I think, that they said on certain sections. So there are some ups and downs going through the mountains.
Isn't it like a sort of trucker route, though? I mean, primarily it's for truckers.
Yeah. So from what I read, it was created for the Trans-Alaskan pipeline. So basically it's meant for big trucks. So it's not meant for like small vehicles. And so it hasn't been graded for that. So there is a lot of loose gravel. And from what I saw, it's like 50 or 55 miles per hour. So there are going to be trucks that are riding along and that are going at speed. And they're going to be kicking up a lot of the gravel.
Yeah, these guys just blast through, right? These are like ice road trucker type, like hardcore trucker guys. And they're blasting through, kicking up gravel and, you know, maybe pelting Moxie in the snout.
Yeah. So not very good for that. The other thing that they were saying, they say it's one of the most dangerous roads. I don't know. It's on one of those lists.
I mean, they have one like that in Bolivia. That's the death road. And it wasn't so deathy to me.
Yeah.
I'm still here, but I hear you.
The thing about the Dalton is that it gets up to Dead Horse. And Dead Horse is still a distance from Prudhoe Bay. So Prudhoe Bay is actually the last town that is on the Arctic Ocean. So that distance is like 8 miles or 13 kilometers, and you need a private tour in order to go and see the Arctic Ocean if you're going to go up this route. And the main reason is because there are oil exploration happening there, and I think it's owned by Halliburton. Mm-hmm. And so they are the ones who are sort of in control of that area. So you do need to take a tour. So it's not like you can just ride up the highway, get off, and then there you are at the Arctic Ocean.
So basically you pull up and you've just done all these many 666 kilometers of mostly off-road, and you're super excited, and you pull in, and that is not the Arctic Ocean.
No.
That is a mining town.
Yeah.
Okay.
It is a very popular route to be like going to the top of Alaska. That's what a lot of people, motorcyclists, will do for that
stretch.
Yeah,
no question.
Yeah.
That's the sort of, when you talk about I'm going north, I'm doing a north to south or something like that.
Prudhoe Bay.
You're talking about Prudhoe Bay.
Yeah.
Alaska. So it just has that fama, that like notoriety.
And it is the Pan American.
Uh-huh.
That would be the stretch. That's what you would take. For the north to south. One of the other things that people were saying online about the Dalton in Alaska is that there's more wildlife. You see more wildlife on that side than you do on the Canadian side.
Now, could this be a case of like reporting bias? More people doing the route means more animal sightings.
Yeah.
Because there's more people to sight. So does that necessarily
mean... More people to sight?
There are more people sighting. More observers observing.
I thought they were observing other people.
No, they're sighting the animals. They're the observers of. So it's a bias potentially, as opposed to there's actually like a denser greater number of wildlife in Alaska than some few hundred kilometers over. Yeah,
exactly. Okay. So I don't know if I really believe that. I have seen
myth. Strikes me as myth.
So that's a key thing for me about wanting to do this, because I want to be able to see all the different wildlife.
Jess wants to get her ass chased by a bear.
No, I don't. I just want to see one at a distance.
You want a revenant type
situation. No, I don't. I just want to see it at a distance.
Okay, from a distance.
In terms of gas and services, both of the highways have a bit of an issue. There are stretches where there are no services. So on the Dalton side for Alaska, the stretch between, I think it's Coldfoot and Dead Horse at the top, there is a 390-kilometer stretch.
There are, like, a lot of names going on that are not, like, sunny and friendly names. Coldfoot sounds bad to me. I mean, if anything shouldn't be cold, you do not want your feet cold. And Dead Horse. Like, yeah. I got here, finally, and my horse is dead. And I hope that doesn't, like, translate over to our motorcycles, please.
So there is that stretch that doesn't have services. So for that, we're going to be okay. We do have the Giant Loop Armadillo gas bags, and so that's what's going to help get us through that stretch.
So I will be carrying two-gallon gas bags, one probably on top of each pannier.
Yeah, and that should be sufficient. So that's the Dalton. The Dempster is on the Canadian side. And so that one, it is, I think, 740 kilometers in distance. So it is longer. There is more dirt because, like I said, it's 98% dirt in comparison to the 75. But the way that the road was constructed, supposedly, it makes for a bit of a smoother ride. And it's because of the permafrost that they've put down like an additional like level of gravel to help compact it so that the road doesn't sort of sink into the land.
Get consumed by Mother Nature.
Yeah. So that supposedly makes for a smoother ride. I don't know how true that is. There is a lot more information, obviously, on the Dalton than there is on the Dempster.
Which is kind of enticing in and of itself that there's a little less known about it. Not by any means that we are like, you know, paving a way through the wilderness. It's a road.
Yeah.
Just that it's less frequented.
Yeah.
Now, the gas situation on the Dempster?
On the Dempster, so the longest stretch is actually near the beginning, just outside of Dawson City up to Eagle Plains. There is a stretch that is...
Now, notice Dawson City, Eagle Plains. This isn't Coldfoot, Dead Horse, Stinky Clothing. I mean, these are like names that don't make you tremble in your boots.
So that stretch, I think it's like 69 kilometers without services. So again, our fuel bags, our gas bags are going to be able to handle that. Coolest part of the Dempster is that you actually get to the Arctic Ocean. So once you get to Tuktoyaktuk, you basically have the sign there from what I've seen that it's like, here you are, the Arctic Ocean, and you can go into the water. And so how cool would that be if like Moxie dismounted and she was able to just put her paws right into the ocean?
Well, I'd like to dismount and put my paws into the Arctic Ocean. And I don't think that's a comparison that can really be underappreciated. Mm. I mean, that's a big deal, right? You've done this whole trek. You're going as far north as you possibly can on the continent. And you get to the shoreline. I mean, you get to the end of the earth, as it were. Mm-hmm. I mean, let's be dramatic about it. You get there, and there is the ocean, and the Arctic Ocean is there. There's no tour that you're taking. There's no, you know...
You did it all on your own steam.
Yeah, you got there, and then you hoofed down, and there's water, and you're in it. Mm. I think there's a lot to be said for that.
Yeah. One of the issues that I did read about is that the last stretch between Inuvik and Tuktoyaktuk, which is that new stretch of the Dempster or not, it has the deepest gravel part of it. And so it's like, what did I say? It was like 80 miles?
130-140 kilometers, something like that.
So that's the last stretch. And so it does...
They really make you earn it.
Yeah. Yeah. So it does make me a little bit worried. And the other concern is on both of the highways is if it does rain, supposedly it can get really muddy and really slick. So it's not going to be an easy ride. And for both of them, it's not just like you're going up and then you get to go on a nice highway back down. It is a up and down. So there is a return trip. So everything that you do up, you're going to have to do back down. So that's something that we also need to keep in mind, that like doing 740 kilometers up, you got to do that back in the dirt. So both of them are going to be quite difficult for us, I think.
Now, when you think about this last like 130-140 kilometers of the Dempster, mm-hmm. It does strike me that if it really is that bad, I mean, that is... that is a challenging hoofing distance for Moxie.
Yes.
I mean, that's not like she can hoof this in a day.
No.
So, you know, we let Moxie down just like you would any human pillion or passenger, sort of for stretches where it's a little more technical or whatever. And she's happy to run alongside and no problem. She gets some good exercise. That's for like a few kilometers here and there. That's not for a 130 kilometer stretch running alongside.
Yeah, so obviously the dirt, the gravel concerns me. This whole trip was about accepting the challenge. And so I was the one who said that I wanted to get to the top, be it either Dead Horse / Prudhoe Bay or to Tuktoyaktuk. So it is
a great name.
So it is on me about wanting to do this. And the good thing is I've been doing a lot of practicing lately. I've been doing some off-road courses from some really great instructors. And
so you
getting
did
those techniques.
Dart at Overland Expo.
Yeah.
That was a short one during the expo, and that was really great.
Mm-hmm.
And then Rawhide was just awesome.
Mm-hmm.
And you worked with Gina.
Mm-hmm.
And she finally got you standing up like a proper adventure rider.
Yeah.
And really, for Jess, like, there hasn't been a backslide, which is great to see. Like, she is now standing on the off-road.
Well, the cool thing about the training with Gina was that she actually rode on the back for some of the skills. So it was like having a Moxie on the back. She was heavier than a Moxie, but a Moxie on the back nonetheless. So that was really cool. And you're going to see that in one of the upcoming Go Roughly Around the World episodes. That should be in the next couple of weeks. But I have been doing a lot of practicing. And even here, as we've been doing our rides, we've been bypassing some of the main roads and purposefully taking some of the dirt stretches just to get some more practice. So I have been doing some more gravel, more dirt. We've been going into some of the mud as well. So it is getting me ready for that. I don't know if I'm going to feel 100% confident going into this in the next few weeks, but I know that I have the right skills and I'm going to be continuing to practice during this time. And look, I'm going to take it easy, right? Like, if we get to a point and I sort of feel like this is too much, there's nothing stopping us from pulling off and camping for the night and relaxing or taking a break. And then if I still feel like as we continue it's getting to be too bad, look, I've got an ego in saying that, like, I do want to make it to the top. That was the goal. But look, if we can't make it, like, we can't make it. There's so many wonderful places that we're going to see on this earth as we travel this adventure that if we don't make it to the Arctic Ocean, I think I can live with that.
Yeah, accepting the challenge is about stepping outside your comfort zone for sure. It's about pushing your limits a little bit, but it's also not about, like, killing yourself or making yourself miserable
or
in danger.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So look, we'll see what we can do. Either of those stretches is definitely going to be putting us to our top of my skill level. Greg, I'm sure, is going to feel a lot more comfortable.
These are heavily loaded bikes carrying additional gas and mm-hmm. all of our gear. It's going to be a challenge.
Yeah.
Either road, either way, it's going to be a challenge.
So that brings us to what tires we're going to use for that part of the trip. If we're going to do the Dalton, then we'll probably switch them out in Fairbanks. And if we're going to do the Dempster, it might be Fairbanks as well, or maybe Dawson City. We haven't figured that out yet. We're both running the Dunlop Trail Max on the front of our bikes. The back tires we have right now, I have a 70-30, which was like the only thing that I could find when we switched them out in Mexico. And Greg, what's yours again?
It's a 50-50 that shall not be named because I don't like it much, and I definitely want to change it.
Yeah. So we obviously need something a bit more aggressive for that stretch of the road, especially for the deep gravel. So I'm thinking that I might stick with the Trail Max, which is a 50-50, because I do like it.
Very good option.
Yeah. The other option, when we were at the Touratech rally, we spoke to the guys at Moto's Tires, the ones from Australia, and they have some really cool options that are pretty aggressive. So they have
the 50-50.
50-50, so which is the Tractionator GPS.
And if you flip it backwards, it's 60-40. So
yeah,
it's even a little more aggressive, they say.
Yeah. So there's that option. And then they also have the 70-30, 70 off-road, 30 on-road, and that's the Adventure. We didn't see that one in person, but I saw the photos of what it looks like. And it's a knobby.
It's a bit more knobby, yeah.
The issue with the GPS, the 50-50 one, is that it's like the Hide and Out, where it has that strip down the center. And that's cool for riding on pavement. So it gives you, it's a bit of a smoother ride. It gives you a little mm-hmm. bit more traction. But if we're going to be doing this, I sort of feel like we need to have a more aggressive tire. And without having like the disconnection between the knobs on the tire in the front, it doesn't give you that ability to turn up the gravel as well. So I'd like to try something a little more aggressive. So I'm thinking that maybe the Adventure, the 7030, or even the Trail Max on the back as well. And we can give that a try. And from what the guys at Moto's tires were telling us, I think they said that the 5050 can last like 10,000 miles, I think they said. And then the 7030, their Adventure, is like five or 7,000. So look, I want the best tire for this. If that means that we're gonna have to change them as we get back down and start doing more of like the interstate as we go across, not interstate, but on the highway as we go across Canada, then so be it. I think it's worth the feeling of comfort and safety to have the right tires for that stretch.
Yeah, I don't think that we want a situation where we don't make it to either of these destinations, whichever one we go after, and it sort of comes down to, I think we might have gone a little too light on the tire. We should have had something more aggressive, and it would have made the difference.
Yeah, that's a good point. If you guys have any good suggestions about tires that we should be using for this type of dirt, deeper gravel,
this particular application,
yeah, we'd love to hear it. If you guys have been following us, you know that I ride the G650 GS and Greg's on the F700. So if you know about a tire that you think that we should be using, please put it in the comments below so that we can check it out. Because it's going to be in the next few weeks that we are going to be changing the tires and doing the route. So we need your advice. Which route should we take? Should we do the Dalton in Alaska or should we do the Dempster in Canada?
Is it Prudhoe Bay or Tuktoyaktuk?
So let us know. If you've done either of them, please put in your feedback about how you found the road. So we are going to be starting one of these roads in the beginning of July. So that's sort of the timing and the weather that we should be expecting. So we'll make it up to the top by the end of July and then make our way down at the beginning of August. So keep that in mind. If you have ridden the road before, either of them during that time, tell us what it was like. We'd love to hear what your feedback is. It makes me a little bit anxious that we're doing this, just because the dirt always makes me anxious. But I am excited about it. I'm excited to see all of the wildlife and to really test my skills. So we'll see how that goes. And I hope you guys will be able to give us your advice and experiences and help lead us to make the right decision for us. Thank you guys so much for watching. Don't forget to subscribe to us here on YouTube. Next week, a new episode will come out for GoRUFFLY Around the World. So make sure that you're subscribed and you have your notifications turned on. And you can follow us at GoRUFFLY for Facebook and Instagram to get some up-to-date info about what we're up to. Thanks so much for watching, guys, and we'll talk to you soon.